Okay, it's raining today, and usually in the Bible, rain means God's grace and mercy. Actually, so I'm praying that today we'll receive God's grace and mercy in this Bible seminar. So before we start, let's pray together. Our gracious Father in heaven, we are here again to listen to your word. And today is the last day of the Bible seminar. And Lord, we want to know what kind of condition we are in before you. And we are such a great sinner before you, speaking lies right after birth. So we need you, Lord. So this time, humble ourselves so that we can admit that we need your help and we need your salvation when we stand before you. So as your word is preached, please help us to listen carefully so that we can understand your will through the word of God. There are some who are still on the way. Please bring them here safely so that we can be together. And from the beginning to the end, I commit the rest of time unto your mighty hand. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Okay, let's turn to Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Let's read it together. And as it is appointed for man to die once, but after this, the judgment. We just read Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27. Before we start, let me just summarize what we have covered so far. So if you remember, I talked about the creation in the first session. Creation is one of the evidence for the Creator because it's a wonderful design, shows God's power and wisdom. Also, I talked about the Bible, the most amazing book, and also the Spirit in us. Also, we covered the Garden of Eden and some other stories in the Bible because they are all true stories, like the Garden of Eden, Noah's Flood, Sodom and Gomorrah, Tower of Babel, also Exodus. The reason why we are studying these things is to make sure that the Bible is true, even all the stories, and there's one people, very special people God chose, the Israel, God's chosen people, and God called them my witnesses, right? So when they were obeying God, they were blessed. When they disobeyed God, they were cursed. And from their history, we come to know that God is behind them. God is the one who, God is protecting them, fighting for them, right? And now Israel has been restored, which is one of the important sign of Jesus' second coming. And we know that even if Jesus comes today, we cannot say anything because all the signs which will happen before his coming are happening right now. So we have to be ready. And from all this story, what we can say is, let's read it together. The Bible is true. God does exist, right? The Bible is true and God does exist. That was the point I made in the last three sessions. And now, as we just read Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, there's one prophecy which is really, surely happened. As it is appointed for men to die once. Everyone dies, and then we'll stand before God someday. It will happen. Whether you like it or not, whether you expect it or not, it will happen, right? So, I will just show you one story. What happens when you die? Okay, what happens when you die? And this is based on Luke chapter 12, the story of the foolish rich man. So let me just show you the story. The title is, This Was Your Life. There was a very rich man who is enjoying his life. And he had a nice house, nice car, and his life was perfect until one day he died. Maybe heart attack, you know, because it is appointed for man to die once. And then in his funeral, many people came, and then they were remembering him, saying he was a good man, and he's in his coffin. And suddenly he heard some voice saying, "Arise, arise." And the problem is, he never believed in God. He never believed in heaven and hell. He just thought when he dies, that will be the end. So he's so shocked. He's saying, "What's happening? Wait, I'm dead. It's all over. It's over," he thought. "Is it really over?" No, it's not. What happened was, the angel came to take him to the judgment seat of God, right? So he cannot believe it. He says, "Judgment? No, you don't understand. Heaven and hell are here on earth. I've always said that." He believed that heaven and hell, when he's happy, he's in heaven. When he's sad, he's in hell. He didn't believe the heaven and hell are really there. But so that's why he is very shocked and surprised. And then angel says, "Come, you have an appointment." So he's asking, "Will anyone else be there?" Oh yes, quite a number. Because everyone, you know, when they die, they are going to see God. They will stand before God. So there is your destination. And he cannot still believe. He says, "I simply refuse to believe this is happening to me." And while he was waiting, he said, "Look, I've lived a real good life. I was no different than anyone else." Because now he knows he's facing the judgment, right? And the angel says, "Everything has been recorded. Don't worry. You don't have to worry about what kind of judge God is, because he's a just judge. He knows everything. He recorded everything." So finally, he's standing before God. In Revelation chapter 20, we'll see that later, there's a story of the white throne judgment. White throne judgment, meaning God is sitting on the white throne, and he will judge everyone, one by one. Right? And God said, "Review his life." "Yes, Lord." And then on the big screen, this person's life has been unfolded, and this was your life. And he was so surprised to see him as a baby, so he said, "Look, that's me as a baby. Does that mean that everything I ever done is going to be reviewed?" Of course. The problem is, sometimes we forget what happened in our life, what kind of sin we committed before. So that's why we think we are okay, because we don't remember all our sins. Don't worry, God already recorded everything. So he was so surprised to see, he was speaking some dirty joke with a friend. "Hey guys, this is the dirtiest story I ever heard. It goes like this." And then they were enjoying this dirty joke, and then he was so shocked, right? "No, stop." And then one time he was watching a lady secretly in a lustful way. And he said, "Wow, nice." So he's saying, "I remember that doing that, but no one saw me." Well, God was watching him all the time. And every day, all the sins he committed, like he lied, he stole something, he was spreading the rumors, and then he was disobedient to the parents, and he was very proud, and then all kinds of things he has ever done was being reviewed before God. Right? And he said, why didn't someone warn me about all this? Why nobody told me there would be judgment? And one time he was in the church, by the way, so he said, "Look, I was in the church." And then the pastor was preaching the gospel, actually, but he didn't care. He was thinking something else. "I couldn't care less. What time is it?" He didn't listen. So be careful. You know, God is even watching you now, right? Are you listening carefully? Okay. And then he just left the church. He said, oh, I don't need God. I don't need Jesus Christ. I will just make it my way. I don't believe God. And now he realized what kind of mistake he made. He says, what can I say? I'm lost without hope, without Christ. I'm guilty, guilty. He's guilty of all the sins he committed, right? And then God says, open the book of life. You know the book of life? The book of life contains the names of all the born-again people. And the angel says, his name does not appear, Lord. And this is the final sentence from God. God said, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. Depart from me. I don't know you. Depart from me. No. And then the angel took him and cast him into the lake of fire. This lake of fire is burning eternally, actually. No hope of escape, no chance to escape. This is the place where the sinners suffer eternally, without ceasing. Okay? No chance to get out of this place, right? The problem is, this can be your life, right? How can you believe this is true? Because, as I told you, we already studied the Bible, earthly things, and then we believe now whatever written in the Bible are true. All these stories in the past and all these prophecies and what are happening right now, especially yesterday we saw many kinds of signs are happening before Jesus comes again. Do you remember? There will be false Christ, there will be rumors of wars and wars and disease, earthquakes, right? Famines, and the earth is dying, all these things. And everything is ready for the Antichrist and the 666 mark and the last war when this Russia is invading Israel. So we covered quite a lot, and the conclusion is the Bible is true. The Bible is true. It's the Word of God. There's no book like the Bible. And the Bible says, as we read in the beginning today, as it is appointed for man to die once, but after this, the judgment. When you die, it's not the end, because there will be resurrection. There will be resurrection. By the way, the Bible says there are two kinds of resurrection. How many kinds of resurrection? Two. Okay, so John chapter 5, verse 28-29. Let's read it together. Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. So you see, there are two kinds of resurrection. Resurrection of life for the born-again people, saved people, but the resurrection of condemnation for the sinner. There are only two kinds of resurrection. There is nothing in between. Nothing in between. Okay? I told you yesterday, if you are not so sure whether you are born again or not, you are not. Okay? Because if you are truly saved, you know you are saved. So, remember, there's a resurrection of everyone. All who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. Your spirit never dies, right? And you will stand before God, who is the judge. God is the judge. Of course, you hear again and again in the church, like 1 John chapter 4, God is love. So some people say, God is love. God loves me. Of course, God loves you. God loves you. However, God is also righteous and just. We see that again and again in the Bible, Psalm number 7, verse 11 to 13. Let's read it together. God is a just judge, and God is angry with the wicked every day. If he does not turn back, he will sharpen his sword. He bends his bow and makes it ready. He also prepares for himself instruments of death. He makes his arrows into fiery shaft. God is a just judge. Just judge means he will judge according to the law. Okay? He has no partiality. So, he will sharpen his sword. Sword. Why? To punish the sinners. If you have only one single sin, you'll be judged for that sin. Right? So God is righteous judge, just judge. He is angry every day. Why he's angry? Like in the Noah's time, people keep committing sin again and again and again, lying, sexual sins or stealing, all kinds of sins people commit every day. God is angry. Okay? It's like a poking his eyes. When you commit sin, you are breaking the law of God, and it is poking his eyes that much. God hates sin. So one day, when you die, you will stand before the judgment seat. So today's topic is a sin of man and its consequence, the judgment. Sin and judgment. And listen carefully, because this is what will happen to everyone. So the question people ask is, actually this is what we will cover today. What is sin? What is sin? And who is a sinner? Am I a sinner? You have to think about yourself. What is in my heart, actually? We don't even know how sinful we are, how bad we are. We don't know, because your friend says you are okay, you are good friends. Because, you know, we have our own standard. But God has his own standard. So today we'll see with what kind of law God will judge us. And will there be judgment for my sins? Of course, there'll be judgment. Our conscience knows. So I will answer all these questions. So sin is very simple. Sin is breaking the law. Breaking the law. If you break the law, it is sin. Okay? If there's no law, it's not sin. Okay? God gave us the Bible, and this Bible is called the law of God. And if you break any single law of the Lord of God in the Bible, you have already broken the law, and you have committed sin. Okay. We want to enter the heaven, right? We want to go to heaven. And heaven is the kingdom of God, and in kingdom of God, God has his own law, and we have to know God's law. If you want to go to some foreign country, you have to know the country's law. So I will give you an example. In Singapore, they have very strict law, by the way. For serious crime, they are beating you, actually. They call it caning in Singapore. For serious law, like adultery or this kind of law, up to 24 times you will get beaten in Singapore if you commit serious law. We don't have such a law in Korea, right? And the speed of the stroke is 160 kilometers per hour. Wow, faster than car, actually. When they beat, right? 160 kilometers per hour, and then they beat you up to 24 times. And the doctor is right there to see your condition, and if your condition is too bad, they say, okay, you come back 6 months later because you are not in good health. And then the 6 months is a terrible time because they are thinking, oh, I'll get beaten again, right? And look at this. This man in Singapore, he was fined 1,000 Singapore dollar, which is around 760 US dollar, for drinking alcohol in public after 10:30 p.m. After 10:30 p.m., you cannot drink alcohol. Never. Okay? And then if you get caught, you have to pay 1,000 Singapore dollar. Not only that. Suppose you visited some washroom and you didn't flush the toilet. Somebody finds it, and you will get fined US dollar $150. Okay? I was wondering, how can people know that you didn't flush the water, the toilet? What happens is this. You use the toilet, and you went out, and somebody came after you, and then he found, oh, that guy didn't flush the toilet. And then he's reporting it to the police. And you cannot get out of Singapore until you pay the fine. Okay? To go to heaven, we have to know the law of God, right? Because heaven is the kingdom of God. If you want to go to Singapore, you have to know the law of Singapore. If not, you are in trouble. Just like that. If you want to go to heaven, you should know the law of God, because heaven is the kingdom of God. That's why God gave us the Bible, so that whether we are sinner, to let us know whether we are sinner or not. The Bible is like a mirror, and it shows our condition, whether we are sinner or not. And let me start with a story about how sin entered the world, the origin of sin. If you remember, yesterday, when I was talking about the Garden of Eden, I told you the Garden of Eden was a perfect place, without sin, without work, without death, without sickness. It was a perfect place for Adam and Eve. But they were cast out of Garden of Eden. Why? Because something happened in Garden of Eden. This is what happened. Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Let's read it together. Therefore, just as through one man, sin entered the world, and death through sin. And thus death spread to all men, because all sinned. Through one man. One man means Adam, the representative of all humankind. And because of him, everyone, the whole world, became sinner. Now, the world population is 7.6 billion or more. It's increasing. But one thing I know for sure is, according to the Bible, they are all sinners. There's no exception. And you are not exception. Why? Because of one man, Adam, we all became sinners. So let's see what happened. There were two kinds of the tree in the Garden of Eden. One is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And the other one was tree of life. And God gave Adam the specific commandment in Genesis chapter 2, verse 17. Let's read it together. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat, for in that day you eat of it, you shall surely die. This was the only commandment from God. Right now, in the Old Testament, we have 613 laws. But that time, only one law. Do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Let me ask you one question. Was it easy or difficult to keep this law? What do you think? How many trees were there in the Garden of Eden? So many trees. How do you know? When you see the petroleum we are getting from that area, that means there were so many animals, so many trees were there. Which means, actually, you know, this is only one tree. They don't have to go near the tree, right? They can eat the fruits from other trees. By the way, Adam was very smart because he gave the names for all these animals. He was very smart, intelligent. He knew exactly what it means. Eating of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is a rebellion against God, is a disobedience against God. So God made it clear, when you eat of it, you shall surely die. And of course, Satan came through the serpent. Satan said the opposite. You will not surely die. You don't die. You'll become like a God. Don't worry. No. So this is Adam's choice. Only two ways are there. No. So God said, do not eat, you shall not eat. And Satan said, eat. Do you know, before us also, always there are two ways. You know, believe and be saved. Believe Jesus Christ and be saved. Or do not believe and go to hell. Listen to the word of God or ignore the word of God. Right? Only two ways. But Adam, he listened to Satan, right? Actually, what happened was, Eve, the wife, she was the one who took the fruit first, and she gave it to her husband. Genesis chapter 3, verse 6, let's read it together. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. So that's what happened. Eve took it first, and then gave it to her husband. And there's one question remaining. God said, if you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall surely die. But what do you think? Adam and Eve died on that day or not? They didn't die physically. So was God wrong? No. what happened is this one. In Ezekiel chapter 18 verse 4, the soul who sinned shall die. So what died on that day? Their soul. What does that mean? Before the sin, Adam and Eve had a very close fellowship with God, but now this fellowship is broken. So they were hiding when God was searching for them. Adam, where are you? And Adam and Eve were hiding, right? Because the relationship was broken. And later he said, I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. The fellowship was broken. His soul died at that time, right? What is death? In the Bible, death is always separation, okay? Death is not the end, death is separation. When you die, your soul and your body, your spirit and your body are separated, okay? It's not over, only separation. So here, he died because he was cut off from God. The fellowship with God was broken, and from this time on, all his descendants were born with spirit death, right? And God really hates sin. You have to remember one thing. God is holy. No matter how much God loves you, God really loves you, but God hates sin, right? Psalm number 5, verse 4, let's read it together. O God, you take no pleasure in wickedness. You cannot tolerate the sins of the wicked. That's why sinner cannot go to heaven, because heaven is a holy place. Isaiah chapter 59 verse 1 and 2 says, listen carefully, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, nor his ear heavy that it cannot hear. But the underlying part, let's read it together, your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. Your iniquity, your sin have separated you from God. So Adam and Eve had very close and intimate fellowship before, but with their sin, they were separated. And you and I are also separated from God because the sin is blocking. So let me ask you, are you a sinner? Yes, because you are also Adam's descendant. I am a sinner too. Why I'm a sinner? Because my father was a sinner. And why my father was a sinner? Because my grandfather was a sinner. And why my grandfather was a sinner? Because my great-grandfather was a sinner. And if you keep going up and up and up, who is there? Who's there? Adam. My name is Yohan Kim. My family name is Kim. There are so many Kims in Korea, you know that, right? Yeah. Somebody says, if you throw a stone, it will hit one of Kims. I didn't choose my family name. It's family name. It was given to me because my father was Kim. Family name is Kim, right? And then it was given to my father from my grandfather. It kept coming like this. So, we didn't choose, you know. It's not our choice. We are all sinners because of Adam. And that's why the Bible says, this is David's confession in Psalm number 51, verse 5. Let's read it together. For I was born a sinner, yes, from the moment my mother conceived me. From that instant that my mother conceived me in her womb, I'm a sinner. And I have evidence. I have evidence that you are sinner, I'm sinner. What evidence? The fact we are sinner means that we have a sinful nature in our heart. Sinful nature. Because this sinful nature was inherited from Adam. We have this sinful nature. Let me give you an example. Do you know this crab? Crab goes sideways, right? It's the nature of a crab. Nature means this crab cannot change the way it's walking. Have you seen any crab going forward? What if you hit it? Go forward. Huh? Can it change its nature? No. The nature is there from the birds that this crab goes sideways. Also, look at this. This tiger cub, when it's little, its nature doesn't show, actually. That's why we say that babies looks like they are look like an angel. You know? So pure, really. They also have the sinful nature. So tigers are tiger from birth. Tigers has this nature. They are very fierce, killing, violent, savage. So when they are young, they can play with these dogs. But when they grow up and when they become big, they show their nature. And I heard this one story in one zoo. The tiger cub was growing with these dogs when it's young, and they played with each other, you know. But when tiger grew up and when it was hungry, what happened? This tiger killed the dog and eat it. Why? It's in its nature. What about us? The Bible says, Psalm number 58, verse 3, let's read it together. These wicked people are born sinners. Even from birth, they have lied and gone their own way. Let me ask you, have you lied? Have you lied? If you say, I never lied, that's the biggest lie, right? So, has anyone, like your father or mother, taught you how to lie? Has your father said, okay, son, you need to know how to lie if you want to survive in this world. And this is how you lie. Okay, when you lie, you should be bold, okay? So that no one can notice you are lying, okay? And you have to really think about it carefully, because you have to make a really nice story, something like that. Nobody taught you how to lie, right? But we just start lying from the birth that is in our nature. So, that's what the scripture says. We were born as sinner. We have this sinful nature. And sometimes we don't even know what's going on in our heart, but God knows. God knows what's going on in our heart. That's why in Proverbs chapter 26, verse 24, 25, let's read it together. He who hates disguises it with his lips and lays up deceit within himself. When he speaks kindly, do not believe him, for there are seven abominations in his heart. Okay, he who hates, when you hate someone, you hate someone. But you don't say that. You know, you hide your feeling. Because you cannot say to other person, I hate you. No, you cannot do that, right? So you're hiding your emotion, your feeling. So this is what happens. There's someone you really hate, but you met him on the street on the New Year's Day, for example. What do you say? On the New Year's Day. Happy New Year! Right? But in your heart, what do you think? No? I hope you get sick this year. Okay? Like that. I hope your business go bankrupt this year. No? When he speaks kindly say, Happy New Year, do not believe in him, for there are seven abominations in his heart. What is this seven abomination? This seven abomination means that in our heart, we have some seven sinful nature represented by these animals. So I will explain what kind of seven abomination we have in our heart. So this is your heart, okay? This is your heart, my heart. There are seven animals here representing all kinds of sins, and in the middle there's a devil. So devil is provoking you sometimes. This devil is provoking some animal from time to time so that you show, you know, your sinful nature. Angel and Holy Spirit cannot enter your heart because your heart is so sinful. And this eye, look at this eye. This represents the Holy Spirit in your heart. God is watching everything. God is watching whatever going on in your heart, right? So this is your heart. So I'll explain one by one what kind of sinful nature you have. So don't think about others. Today, don't think about others. Think about yourself. Some people think, yes, my brother is so bad. My sister is very bad. She's a sinner. Of course, she's a sinner, but you are also a sinner. So today is about you. So the first one is peacock. You know peacock? Peacock represents pride. Pride. Sometimes you are very proud. Suppose you are good looking, you look beautiful, then you become proud. If you are smart, you are proud, ignoring others, despising others. Let me ask you, suppose you are very beautiful or you are good looking. Is it because you are good or is it because God made you that way? It's God's grace, by the way. So, in Romans chapter 1, verse 30, in Romans chapter 1, there's a list of these sinners, backbiters, haters of God, violent, and who? Proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents. These proud people, those who are boasting about what they have, they are sinners. They are sinners. We have received everything from God, so why are you proud? If you are proud and if you hurt feelings of others by boasting, you committed sin. Okay? Secondly, there's a goat which represents stubbornness. Goat is very stubborn. So if you want to pull it, it is resisting you, and then goat shows stubbornness. And you know what? The children are very stubborn. Right? They want something like a candy. Give me candy. And then mother says, nope. And what does he do? He's just lying on the ground and, you know, moving around. Very stubborn. We are all stubborn, but among all kinds of stubbornness, let me tell you one thing. The spiritual stubbornness. Spiritual stubbornness. What do I mean by spiritual stubbornness? I know some of you are Christians. Some of you have been coming to church for a long time. But you are not so sure about your salvation. You know, you don't know when Jesus comes, you'll be raptured or not. You have some doubts or you have some fear in your heart about your salvation, but you never show it. That's stubbornness. No. Your stubbornness can kill you, actually. You have to humble yourself. God, I still have some fear. I have some doubt about my salvation. Please help me this time so that I have a clear understanding of salvation today, like that. So, Romans chapter 2, verse 5, let's read it together. But in accordance with your hardness and your impenitent heart, you are treasuring up for yourself wrath in the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God. Don't make your heart hard. Impenitent means you don't repent. We have to admit our sins, okay? The third one, pig, means greed. Pigs are very greedy. They want to eat again and again. What about you? We are so greedy. Do you know how to catch a monkey in an easy way? There's a very easy way. This monkey is somehow very greedy. So if you use this kind of jar with a this small entrance, and if you put a banana, they try to take out banana, they cannot, and then they are holding it like that so people can come and get this monkey easily. I will show you one video clip showing how to catch this monkey. He is hiding something here, and then this monkey comes.
First, he laboriously drills a hole in
the volume up? Antique,
when he is sure a baboon is watching him, because he knows baboons are incurably
inquisitive. It's a baboon.
Next, he puts some wild melon seeds into the hole and works them in so that they drop into a hollow. Then he saunters off, knowing the baboon is burning with curiosity. The baboon doesn't trust that human being at all, so he plays it cool. But he's dying to know what gives in that confounded hole.
What is there? He's wondering, right? This baboon.
Finally, Mr. Inquisitive can't take it any longer. He's got to know what's in there. He reaches in, grabs a fistful, and now his hand's too big to come out. If he had the sense to drop the seed, he could free his hand. toilet.
So easy, right? This baboon, very greedy, he never let it go, even if the person is approaching him, right?
But we are like this, actually. You know? The scripture says, seek first the kingdom of God, then everything else will be added unto you. There's a promise of God. But many times we choose money over God, actually. Okay? We are very greedy, too. We prepared this seminar, and then if we say, if you attend one session, we'll give you 1,000,000 won. If you announce like that, how many people will come? Everyone in Suwon will come, actually, right? Because we are very greedy. But when we say, you will receive eternal life when you come to the seminar, nobody comes. They say, I don't care about eternal life, right? Only what we can see, this money and material, we are very greedy. So, look at this girl. She's very greedy too. Where is her food? Her food. This banana is mine. No touch. This snake is mine. Don't ever touch, right? This desire is growing in your heart and it will kill you later, right? So James chapter 1 verse 15, let's read it together. Then when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. Desire. First, it starts with desire. Small thing in your heart, but it grows and it becomes sin and it will bring death to you. Like, suppose you are working in some workplace, you are cashier, you are stealing a little bit of money first, but later you steal more and more, and later you go to the prison, something like that, right? So, desire and greed. We have this greed. And the next one is this turtle in the bottom. This turtle, when danger comes, this turtle can hide head and legs, like this, right? So everything inside. So some turtle, when they hiding everything inside, even the elephant can step on it and it's okay. They are very strong, actually. Okay? So what this turtle means is, when you give excuse about your sins, when you try to cover your sins, you are like a turtle, giving excuses. So Proverbs chapter 28, verse 13, let's read it together. He who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy. If you want to receive mercy from God, you have to confess and you have to repent your sins, but many people are covering and hiding their sins like a turtle. Okay, that's the sin we have. We never admit our sins. First, only when there's evidence, then we say, yes, I committed that sin. Okay, next one is here, the frogs, the frog. This frog represents the talkative. They keep talking, gaggle, right? Usually when people come together and when they talk, they are gossiping. You know gossip? Talking about others, bad things, and there's a sin. And we have that nature. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 19. Let's read it together. He who goes about as a talebearer reveals secrets. Therefore, do not associate with one who flatters with his lips. Talebearer is the one who is spreading the rumors. Right? In one village, there was a young lady, not married. She was talking to one married man on the street, like, hi, how are you? They were just saying, is everything okay in your work? They were just talking to each other, and then some people saw them talking, and then they were spreading rumors saying that they are having affair, and then, many rumors spread, and then later the young lady killed herself because she couldn't bear all these rumors. Actually, rumors become bigger and bigger, right? Tale bearer, there's a sin. And men, you see this frog with the red eyes? When men become drunken, their eyes become red. And men, they don't usually talk much compared to women. But when they are drunken, what happens? Keep talking. Right? I know this because my father used to do like that. When he's drunken, he talks about the same thing again and again and again. Right? It's a sin, actually. We have this nature of the frog. And then next one, below the frog is a snake, serpent. And this snake's tongue is divided. And snake has a poison. Poison. So what does that mean? With our mouth or tongue, we can kill others. We have a poison in our mouth. So, James chapter 3, verse 8, let's read it together. But no one can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. In our tongue, we have a poison with which we can kill others. Right? So, James chapter 3, verse 10 says, you know, the snake's tongue is divided. Out of the same mouth proceed blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not to be so. How can you bless people and curse people with the same tongue, same mouth? How can you do that? You know, this tongue is a problem. Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 8, let's read it together. Their tongue is an arrow shot out. It speaks deceit. One speaks peaceably to his neighbor with his mouth, but in his heart he lies in wait. So with our tongue. In America, the Korean people living in America, they make a mistake because when they fight, they say something like this, I will kill you. Of course, in Korea, people say, they don't mean it, but they just say it. But in America, it becomes serious because they think you mean it. Like if you say, I will kill you, they call the police and police will come and get you. Right? So you should be very careful. You can hurt the feeling of others with your mouth. It's worse than beating that person physically, right? And then lastly, there's this lion here. This lion, it represents violence, killing, and hurting others. But of course, among them, they look okay, but actually this lion is killing other animals and hurting others. We have this lion-like nature in our heart. We want to fight, and the Bible gave us warning that if you hate somebody, you are already a murderer. Hating someone and hurting someone, that is lion-like nature. 1 John chapter 3, verse 15, let's read it together. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. So look at this boy. This look is, I hate you, like that, right? So this nature is a lion nature, which is sin. Actually, all the murder starts from hatred. Murder starts from hatred, and this is the sin, right? So let me summarize. This is your heart. And in our heart, we have seven abomination. Abomination means what God hates. Right? Seven abomination is there, and sometimes you don't even know they are there because they are very silent, they don't move, but from time to time it comes out. If you are rich, you have everything, and if you have a good education, then usually these animals are tamed and then they don't show themselves. Often. But from time to time, it comes out. And that's why the Bible says our heart is more deceitful than anything else. Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9 and 10. Let's read it together. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I test the mind even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings. The heart is deceitful above all things. So dirty, so filthy, your heart. I came across this person on the internet, the dirtiest man in the world. He hasn't taken shower for 60 years. I mean, he never took a shower, right? So he's called the dirtiest man in the world. But let me tell you, in God's eyes, you are just like him. Because we cannot see each other's heart, we can live together, right? Even though we hate someone, we don't show it. You know, even though we want to steal something, we don't show it. So we can get along well with each other. But God knows our heart, and if we can see each other's heart, we cannot live together, because the scripture says our heart is deceitful over all things. The most dirty thing in the world is our heart. So look at this. Outwardly, they look okay, especially this looks better, but inside, no, these are garbage. And let me ask you, can you drink some tea in this cup in this condition? No. That's why God cannot take you to heaven. So dirty, so filthy. When we stand before God, like an x-ray, everything will be shown, actually. X-ray is interesting. It shows everything inside, right? The inside your body, just like that. God knows what is in your heart. What is in your heart? All kinds of sins. What happens is, when everything goes well, these sins come down and it looks like you have no sin. But when someone makes you angry, sin comes out, right? So even this little boy, you know, he has a hatred, full of hatred. But do you think it comes from his heart, right? Do you think this girl, who looks very nice, is she a sinner or not? Does she have seven abominations or not? Is she a sinner or so in God's eyes? Yes. Even though she doesn't show. She looks very nice, well-mannered, but the scripture says everyone, because we are Adam's descendant, she also has this dirty sin. So our heart is full of sin, and from our heart, we have bad thought, and then we speak lies, and then in action, we commit many kinds of sins. Sometimes we do not know, but God knows our heart, right? So, this is what happens. Inside, in our heart, we have all kinds of sins. Sometimes we are jealous, we hate someone, we lie, we become arrogant, we disobedient to our parents. But we are covering nicely with our position, like I'm pastor or elder, deacon. And sometimes we try to be a good person, charity and kindness, and then some religion, all kinds of things we are covering. So let me tell you, our heart is like an onion. You know onion? It has many layers. Deep inside, we have this sinful desire. We are covering it nicely, but God knows. And regarding sin, you have to remember one thing. Your sin never and ever disappears. From your birth until you die, your sins will be there, but we forget about them. That's why we think we are okay. And compared to others, you think you are okay, but in God's eyes, your sin is still there. It never and ever will be gone. Okay? So our condition now is just like this. From birth to until now, we committed so many sins. We are carrying them on our back. But once you misstep, you will fall down, you will die. And when you die with these sins, you will end up in hell. And that's our condition before God. And let me show you one thing. In God's eyes, we are such a bad sinner. So Job chapter 25, verse 4 to 6. Let's read it together. How then can man be righteous before God? Or how can he be pure who is born of a woman? If even the moon does not shine and the stars are not pure in his sight, how much less man who is a maggot and a son of man who is a worm? If even the moon does not shine, what does that mean? Only in the 19th century, people invented the telescope. Okay? Before the invention of the telescope, people thought the moon was very nice and smooth, but not now, because now we have a telescope, and even people even went to the moon, and now we know the surface of the moon is not smooth, right? It's rugged, And it doesn't shine, by the way. It's just reflecting the light from the sun. It's not shining. It's not smooth. Now we know. But before we didn't know. Because without telescope, we cannot find it out, right? The moon does not shine. God knows the condition of the moon. God knows our true condition. And before God, we are maggot. You know maggot? This, you know, worm, maggot. Sorry, we'll have lunch soon, but this is our condition before God. Actually, this is what happens. We are all maggots before God, but some maggots think they are okay because, look at this. This is the pit toilet of Korean traditional pit toilet, and you know what was there down here, right? Very dirty, and this maggot is swimming in this place. Very dirty, and then this maggot is a normal maggot, and this one is looking down and say, "Hey, maggots, you are so dirty." And he's clean maggot, right? And then there's another one here. He thinks he's holy maggot. A maggot is still maggot. So if this holy maggot is going to see this man when he's eating, how would he feel when he sees the maggot? Oh, maggot, so dirty, right? No matter how clean this maggot thinks he is, it doesn't matter because maggot is maggot, right? So before God, we are maggot, and we have so many sins before God. Some scholars, they recorded whatever people say every day, and they were checking whether it's a lie or not, and they found out people lie how many times a day? 200 times a day on average. You know, sometimes I see some ladies, girls, they meet each other after a long time. They always say, "Oh, you look so beautiful." So I'm thinking, are they telling the truth or not? Because they always say you look beautiful, right? I don't know. No, just they want others feel good. Sometimes we do that. We lie naturally. So suppose you meet one of your friends on the street and the friend said, "Oh, do you have money? I need money. Can I borrow money from you?" And you know that that friend will not pay you back. And you have money, by the way. And what do you say? You say, "No, I have no money. No, I'm also broke." Easily you say that, right? Because you are a liar. And remember, God will judge what is in your heart. This judgment of God is different from the judgment of this world because this, the law of God, okay, in this world, we have the law, like a Korean law, Singaporean law, and this world law only judge our action. But one thing you have to remember is God knows your heart, and God's law will judge not only your action, but your heart also. Okay? You know, when the airplane crashes, they try to find this black box. You know black box? It's not black, but it's called black box because it is recording everything. The conversation of the pilots and co-pilot, the altitude, the speed, everything is recorded here. So what happens is, God gave you conscience, which is recording everything going on in your heart. These days, there are so many CCTVs. Do you know that? So you are being watched every movement. So like this person, at 8 a.m., he's taking elevator in his apartment and he's going to his office, and during the after lunch, he's drinking something in the convenience store, and later he's leaving his office to go home. Everything is captured these days, right? So many CCTVs. But God put one CCTV in your heart, conscience, which is recording everything. So let's remember, not only your action, but God is looking in your heart. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7, let's read it together. "But the Lord said to Samuel, 'Do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as men see. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart.'" The heart. God knows what is going on in your heart. And God knows whatever secret thing you have in your heart. So God will judge every work and every secret thing. Secret thing. What is secret thing? There's a sin only you know because you did it secretly. Or there's a sin only two people know. Man and woman having affair and adultery. They keep it secret. God knows. All kinds of secret things, right? And they will be revealed before God when you stand before the judgment. And God gave us 10 commandments to make sure you understand you're a sinner. We'll take a 5-minute break, and we'll start again with these 10 commandments. So you can go to the washroom, or you can have tea. So a 5-minute break. Okay? Yeah, we'll start in 5 minutes. So 3,500 years ago, in the Mount Sinai, God gave Moses these 10 commandments. There are 613 laws in the Old Testament, but this 10 commandment is the summary of this, all the laws of God. So these are the 10 commandments. Let me just read. The first, you shall have no other gods before me. And second, you shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything, no image, right? The third one, you shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Like if you say, oh my God, or when you say something terrible, when you say Jesus Christ, you are violating the third one because you should not misuse the name of the Lord your God. For remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Sabbath day is not Sunday. It's from Friday evening to Saturday evening. And the fifth one, honor your father and your mother. You obey your father and mother, and you respect them, and you listen to them. Number six, you shall not murder. You see, this is the order of importance, and honoring your father and mother comes before you shall not murder, which means that if you disobey your father and mother, you committed more serious sin than murder, actually. Because this is the order of seriousness, right? And the seventh one is you shall not commit adultery. And you shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not lie, basically. No lie. Okay? And the tenth one, you shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. What is covet? Desiring something. Like your friend has a nice mobile phone. Oh, I want to have that one too. That's covet. So, you shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. What's important about this 10th commandment is, this 10th commandment is, we can see that as 10 rings connected together. And above these 10 rings, there is what? Heaven. Down here, there is a hell. So you are right here holding onto the last ring, and these are the 10 rings connected together. What happens is, if any of these is broken, you will fall down and go to hell. Right? So let me ask you, how many rings should be broken then you will go to hell? How many rings? One ring, right? You don't have to break all the rings to go to hell. Only one ring you break and then you go to hell. For example, respect your parents. If you disobey your parents, if you lie to them, if you just ignore them, you broke the fifth one. So if you break the fifth commandment, where do you go? Heaven or hell? Hell. If you lie, because the ninth one, no false witness, if you lie one time, you are breaking the ninth ring, and then where do you go? Heaven or hell? Hell. The tenth one, do not covet. If you desire, you wish that you have your friend's car or a house or a mobile phone, computer, you are coveting and you are breaking the last ring, and you will go down to hell. This is not what I'm saying. This is what the scripture, the Bible says. James chapter 2, verse 10. Let's read it together. For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point he is guilty of all. If you stumble in one point, if you break one, then you are guilty of all. And the James said, even if you do not commit adultery, if you commit murder, you have broken the law. If you do not murder, but if you commit adultery, also you've broken the commandment. And that's why we are all sinners before God, because we have broken so many rings, so many commandments. So Romans chapter 3, verse 10, this scripture shows that we cannot go to heaven by keeping the Ten Commandments. No one can keep the Ten Commandments. Let's read it together. Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. Some people say, some Christians say, oh, we have to keep the Ten Commandments. I'm not saying you can break it. I'm just saying we cannot keep all the commandments and we can go to heaven. No way. Because we already broke so many commandments. So, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. There's no one, no single one who can go to heaven by keeping the law. That's what the scripture says. It's not possible. It's not possible to go to law by keeping the Ten Commandments. Then why God gave us this Ten Commandments? To know we are sinner. The Ten Commandments is like a mirror showing our condition. So Romans chapter 3 verse 20 says, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. So let me explain. So Ten Commandments was given to us so that we know we are sinner. When we look at the Ten Commandments, we broke so many commandments. Now we know, oh, I'm a sinner. You know what a sinner means? What the sinner means? Sinner means we are going to hell. Sinner is the name for those who go to hell. So when you say you are a sinner, that means you are going to hell, right? So this mirror. So suppose in the morning, I have some dirt on my face, but if I didn't look at the mirror, then I don't know whether my face is clean or not. But when I look at the mirror, suppose there's something dirty on my face, then how can you wash that thing? Can you wash it with a mirror like this? Or you can go to the water and wash with water, right? You have to wash it with water, not with a mirror. Mirror is just telling you that you're not clean, okay? But the mirror cannot make you clean. Only water can make you clean. Just like that. This law, especially Ten Commandments, they were not given for you to go to heaven. They are showing you you are a sinner. And one more thing you have to remember is Jesus in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus added something more to the law. For example, regarding the murder, Matthew chapter 5, verse 21, 22. Let's read it together. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raka, shall be in danger of the council. But whoever says, you fool, shall be in danger of hellfire. Listen. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder. This is one of the Ten Commandments, the sixth commandment. But I say to you, Jesus says, I say to you. Why? Jesus is the one who will judge us. Right? God gave all the judgment authority to Jesus. So he will judge us. And Jesus says, whoever is, what? Angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raka. Raka means you idiot. Like that. You foolish. You fool. You fool. Right? Raka shall be in danger of the council, but whoever says you fool shall be in danger of what? Hellfire. Remember, if you get angry with your brother, or if you say you fool, you idiot, and if you hate your brother, you are in danger of hell, because already read this scripture, 1 John chapter 3, verse 15. Let's read it again. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Hating someone and murdering someone, in God's eyes, they're the same. And I know the reason. I heard this story. In the prison, there are many murderers. And those people who met them, these murderers, they say, they are not monsters. They are normal people. What happened to us, they were drunken sometimes. They get angry suddenly. There was a knife. They just used the knife to kill others, right? They're not different from us. But they hate someone and suddenly they get so angry and they killed someone else, right? Of course, there are some people who plan on killing someone, but most of them, no. So, whoever hates his brother is a murderer means that in God's eyes, hating someone and killing someone, the same sin. So, let me tell you one thing. Now you are dead and you stand before God. And God will tell you like this. God will say to you, you have murdered 10,000 times. 10,000 times. And you say, God, no, I never murdered anyone. I never killed anyone. Right? And then God will say, haven't you read the Bible? I told you exactly. This is the law of God. I told you, whoever hates brother is a what? Murderer. And you cannot say anything. Right? Because this is the law of God. And these days, especially in Korea, they try to make this abortion legal. And this abortion, killing the baby in mother's womb, is a murder, actually. Okay? Many women says, why you care about what I'm doing with my body? No, this is my body. I can do whatever I want. But God will say, this is a murder because you are killing the baby. Actually, baby and the mother have different blood type. They have different personality. They're individual. And what happens is, in the time of abortion, the doctor kills the baby and take a piece by piece, and the nurse should put them together to make sure that nothing is left in the mother's womb. So some nurse, while doing that again and again, they became crazy. They became insane because they knew it's a killing, actually, right? This baby above, he survived, even though he was born prematurely, 4 months in mother's womb, but he survived. But another one, 4 months in mother's womb, were aborted and died. So this baby could have survived, but they killed, because baby can survive after 4 months, right? Abortion is a murder, and so many are just killing. So many babies are killed every year, actually. In Korea, more babies are aborted than those who are born, actually. Okay? Serious. And regarding adultery, also Jesus added something. You have to take it seriously. Matthew chapter 5, verse 27, 28. Let's read it together. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that whoever looks at a woman to lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. By the way, this adultery is always increasing whenever people become sinful. Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed because of this sexual sin, right? And this adultery and homosexual sins are increasing more and more these last days. But Jesus said, no, not even adultery. If you look at a woman to lust for her, just looking at her, wow, she's nice. She's beautiful. By the way, these days, this is the problem. Because of the internet, because of the mobile phone, no, you can commit adultery easily just by watching some video clip. God will say you have committed adultery. I heard this story. One sister was trying to evangelize one a man from some other country. I don't remember. Thai or... Anyway, so the sister got our Bible seminar video. And she tried to copy them to that person's mobile phone. And she accidentally found so many pornographic video in his phone, actually, right? And she was so shocked, right? So many were there. So, you know, many men, they are hiding some videos here and there, computer or mobile phone, like this. And you'll be surprised when you stand before God. God will say to you, you have committed adultery 20,000 times. And you'll say, God, I never committed adultery. And God will say, no, I told you in the Bible, if you look at a woman in a lustful way, you have committed adultery. That's the same, actually. Why the same? Let me tell you. Suppose husband and wife is there. This husband always look at the neighbor, next door wife, and he is always thinking about her, the neighbor. But he never meets her, he never talks with her, but he always say, think, oh, she's so beautiful, nice, and imagining something, you know. But he never meets her, he never contacts her, no talking, no meeting. Is it sin or not? It's a sin. What if the wife finds it out, what he's thinking? The wife feels okay or not? Wife will feel very bad, right? Even though he didn't do anything, he never met her, he never talked with her, but still, the wife will feel very betrayed because it's a sin. Just like that, this adultery is a sin, okay? What about covetousness? The last law in the Ten Commandments is covetousness. So if you covet like a nice car for men, car or computer, what they want, or for a woman, nice bag, you know. What is this one? Chanel or Gucci? I don't know. Or if you covet some nice house with a swimming pool, whatever you desire is a covetousness. And you have broken the 10th commandment. You shall not covet. So, what does that mean? This is the conclusion. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. Let's read it together. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Everyone in this world, all the Adam's descendants, we have sinned and we fall short of the glory of God. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 20 says, for there is not a just man on earth who does good and does not sin. There's no good man in God's eyes because we fall short of the standard of God. God's standard is so high, we are so, you know, lowly, so we cannot reach God's standard. And in Matthew chapter 5, verse 26, this is what Jesus said. Let's read it together. Assuredly, I say to you, you will by no means get out of there till you have paid the last penny, until you pay the penalty for the every single sin of yours, you cannot get out of hell. So let me ask you one question. Is there anyone who never broke any of these Ten Commandments here? I never broke any of these commandments. I kept all of them. Anyone? No. So that means we are destined to go to hell because we broke so many commandments every day. But the question is, some people ask this question, okay, Pastor, I understand. I committed so many sins and I broke so many commandments. But what about my good work, my righteousness? Sometimes I help others, I pray for others. This good work, does it count or not? What do you think? My own righteousness. You know, let's find it out in the scripture. Isaiah chapter 64, verse 6. This is about your righteousness. Let's read it together. But we are all like an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are like a filthy rags. We all fade as a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. Okay, this part is important. All our righteousnesses, good work, are like what? Filthy rags, dirty rags, like this. Just imagine you go to the wedding ceremony. Your friend is getting married, so you have to go to the wedding party. can you wear something like this and then you can go to the wedding? No. You know, when you go to the wedding, you wear your best, right? But what does that mean? In God's eyes, your righteousness, your good work, is like this dirty rags. It cannot cover you because it does not really satisfy God's standard. Let me give you one example. When I was in India, there was a beggar. You know, beggar? Begging for money. So when I stop my car on the red light, they come and knock the window, and then usually I give 10 rupees, which is like a 200 won, small amount, but they just take it and go away. So I used to give 200 won, but one day I have a lot of money, so, and the beggar looked very miserable, so I gave her like 200,000 won, okay, or 2 million won, suppose. I gave her a lot of money. And I think I have done very good work. But what about, is it really good work in the eyes of God? Because you remember, Matthew chapter 22, Jesus said, there are two commandments. If you summarize 10 commandments, then it becomes two commandments. First one is, love your God with all your heart, all your soul, right? And then the second commandment is, love your neighbor as yourself. So when you help beggars, you have to love those beggars as yourself, which means that you have to take them to your house, you have to give them food, whatever you eat, you have to share them, whatever clothes you have to give them, and if they have no place to stay, you have to let them stay in your place, because that's how you love your neighbor as yourself. Can you do that? God's standard is this high, loving a beggar like yourself, but what I did was giving some money, and I think I have done everything. Suppose that beggar was my sister. Can I just give money to her and then say, go away? No. Right? So, our good work is not perfect, actually, in God's eyes. They are filthy rag, and that's why we cannot stand before God with this good work. So look at this. This is the heaven, and we are sinner with all kinds of sin on our back. By the way, this sin is always a problem. Even if you do all kinds of good work, because of your sin, you go to hell. So, this offering, prayer, position, good deeds, zeal, and Sunday you are going to church and miracle, and you are keeping the law, all this good work, God will say, they are filthy rags. They cannot take you to heaven. So what does that mean? You have no hope before God, because your good work is not perfect. So finally, so this is the last topic today. So when you die, because Hebrews chapter 9 verse 27 we read in the beginning, as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this, after you die, what comes? The judgment. The judgment. So what is the destiny of a sinner? What will happen to a sinner when they face the judgment of God? Okay, this is the destiny of a sinner, let me tell you. This is what happens to everyone, including you. So we were born at one point, and we were born as a sinner, as Psalm 51 verse 5 says, in sin my mother conceived me, and as soon as we are born as a sinner. So as a sinner, we commit so many sins in our life every day. We lie, we steal, and then we covet, we look at a woman in a lustful way, all kinds of sins, and one day we die. The death comes, because it's appointed for men to die once. And after death, there'll be judgment. And because a sinner has so many sins, when we are judged by God, the sinner goes to where? Sinner goes to where? Hell, the eternal lake of fire. And this is the destiny of a sinner, and this is the destiny of everyone in this world. There's no exception. You know, sometimes there's a volcano eruption and this magma, it's very hot. The temperature is 800 to 1200 degrees. This shows that, you know, God prepares some place very hot, actually. Okay. And in Romans chapter 14, when we stand before God, we will confess our sins to God one by one, actually. Romans chapter 14, verse 11 and 12, let's read it together. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then, each of us shall give account of himself to God. The judgment will be individual, and every tongue shall confess to God, which means we will confess our sins to God. God, I did this. God, I did that. Nothing will be hidden. So Mark chapter 4, verse 22, for there is nothing hidden which will not be revealed. This is scary because in this world, sometimes our sin is hidden. So some people, they go unpunished. After committing serious sin, they are covering very nicely. But before God, there's nothing hidden which will not be revealed, nor has anything been kept secret, but that it should come to light. No secret before God, because God knows everything. Hebrews chapter 4 verse 13, let's read it together. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. There's no creature hidden from his sight. Sometimes I think this way. There's a one worker working as a cashier in a shop. Cashier. Okay? And he was stealing money from the, you know, from his shop. And there was a CCTV. CCTV was there recording everything. So one day the owner found out that the money is short, so he watched the CCTV and he found out that that worker, that employee was taking the money. So the owner knows everything. And then the owner is asking the employee, oh, do you know what happened? Because, you know, some money is short. I don't know why, you know, why that happens. The owner knows everything. But the employee, he doesn't admit, and he tried to lie, and he tried to say, oh, I don't know. You are accusing me like that, right? How sad the owner will be because he knows everything. What happens is, God knows even what is going on in our heart. God knows every single action in our life. But we try to hide them. We try to give excuses. That is worse, actually. That is worse sin. Okay? Suppose you have a children. He lied. But if you know he already lied, and then if you see your child trying to keep give some excuses about his lie, it's worse, actually. Okay, you want him to tell the truth. And remember, when you stand before God, there's no creature hidden from his sight. We have to confess, God, I'm such a terrible sinner, because this is what will happen. A little bit long, but this is something called the white throne judgment. The last judgment, final judgment for all the sinner. Revelation chapter 20, verse 11 to 15. A little bit long, but let's read it together. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works, by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and the death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Listen carefully. I saw a great white throne, throne for king. God is sitting there, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away. It's not this world. Earth and heaven fled away. This is the next world. And I saw the dead people. I told you, there's a resurrection. right? Resurrection. Everyone will become alive again. The dead people, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. You see, books, plural. What is this books? The Bible. The Bible is 66 books. It's a collection of 66 books. So the books were opened. You will be judged according to the Bible. Okay? God has given everything to you, all the law by which you will be judged. So books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. This book of life contains all the names of the born-again Christian. And the dead were judged according to their what? Works. Whatever you have done will be judged one by one, one by one. By the things which were written in the books. Again, the books, plural. This is the Bible. That's why we are studying the Bible today, right? We have to know the law. We have to know our destiny. And they were judged each one, one by one, according to his works. Everyone will stand before God one by one. This is the second death. I told you, death is separation. When we die, our spirit and body are separated. That's the first death. Why this is called the second death? Because these sinners will go to hell, separated from God eternally. That's why it's called the second death. Okay? Separation from God eternally. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Look at this. This is the white throne judgment. All the sinners naked. Nothing can cover them. Nothing will be hidden in the sight of God. So one by one, they will come and stand before the Lord, and they'll be judged. And all the sinners, they'll be cast into the lake of fire. So during this great white throne judgment, anyone, if they are not found in the book of life, they'll be cast into the lake of fire. And everyone will be judged according to their works by the things which are written in the books, Bible. And the punishment will be the lake of fire, eternal lake of fire. One time, D.L. Moody, that American preacher, said, "Do not think this hell is a joke. There's no joke. God doesn't joke about hell. Actually, Jesus is the one who talks about hell more than anyone else in the Bible." Right? Jesus mentioned about hell more than 70 times because, look at this, this hell is real, actually. If there's no hell, we can destroy the Bible. We can just, burn this Bible and we don't have to care about this Bible. But hell is there, this eternal lake of fire. There'll be gnashing. Gnashing means, look at me, like this, gnashing your teeth. Why? Because they are suffering so much. When you have such a great pain, you are gnashing your teeth. And they'll be weeping. Weeping means you'll be crying. Why? You had a chance to be born again, but you just ignored them. So when you end up in hell, there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Matthew chapter 22, verse 13. Let's read it together. "Then the king said to the servant, bind him hand and foot, take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." I told you, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Why? Now they know their destiny. They'll be there forever. Matthew chapter 25, verse 41. This one you have to remember. Some people say, how can loving God can create hell? So that's why many people do not believe in hell. Okay, there are many false teachings. They say, God is God of love. Loving God would not make a hell for sinners. Well, the hell was created for devil, not for human. Matthew chapter 25, verse 41. Let's read it together. "Then he will also say to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels." You see here, the everlasting fire prepared for whom? Devil and his angels. So why people go to hell then? Because people follow devil until the end. They don't listen to God. They don't obey God. They say, I like a devil more than you, God. And they follow the devil. Remember, in the Garden of Eden, Adam had choices. He could listen to God or he could listen to Satan. God says, do not eat. Satan said, eat. And then he listened to the serpent, the Satan. Just like that, you have a choice, right? The hell is for devil and his angel, his fallen angels. But so many people choose devil, and that's why they are just following the devil. Hell is a terrible place. That's why Jesus gave this warning in Mark chapter 9, verse 47, 48. Let's read it together. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell, fire, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. Look at this. If your eye causes you to sin by watching something not proper, no? Then if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. Pluck it out. Take it out. Why? You better enter the kingdom of God with one eye than going to the eternal lake of fire with both eyes. In another place, Jesus said, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. If your leg causes you to sin, cut it off. Why? Because it's very serious, right? This is what happened in one of the Islamic country. The Muslims, when you are found stealing something, they cut off your arm. But for this kid, they are like breaking his arm using the truck, actually, because he stole something. He stole something from the store, and they are breaking his arm. Even in this world, the law can be very strict and very severe, and God says, Jesus said, if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. So this hell is not a joke. Let me just summarize what the hell is like. It's a fiery lake of burning sulfur. It's burning. The fire is never quenched. It's burning forever and ever. The worm does not die. Nobody dies. And the sinner will be salted with fire. The fire will be thrown to them, and no rest day and night. You know, even if we are tired during the daytime, when we take a rest in the nighttime, it'll be okay, but there's no rest. And memory remains. This is important. Memory. You will remember everything. Whatever you did in this life, you will remember and you will regret. Oh, the time Pastor Kim was talking about this hell, and now I'm in hell. He said, you know, you will listen carefully next session, then you will be born again, and some people just go away, and they will remember everything. Memory remains, and it's very dark. It's very dark, and eternal separation from your loved ones, and actually you will be separated from God eternally. No chance to escape. It's a terrible place. I will show you one video clip, actually. In hell, the sinners will be salted with fire, and in Korea, to cook some soup, they are really throwing the salt to this, I don't know what's the name of this fish. It's like a, anyway, I will show you, because it's really similar to what will happen to the sinner in hell when the fire is, when they are salted with fire. What happens is they suffer so much, actually. I saw this when I was very young, and I was very shocked to see, because even the skin turns to red, and then they are foaming in around their mouth, and they are dying, suffering. And I came to know, oh, this is hell, actually. This is like hell, right? And it's really terrible, right? But just imagine the real fire will be thrown to the sinners, how much they will suffer. And in Revelation chapter 21 verse 8, there's a list of people who are going to hell. To make sure you understand who is going to hell, Revelation chapter 21 verse 8, let's read it together. But the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Listen, this is the list of people who go to hell. The first one is the cowardly. The cowardly, what does that mean? Those who are afraid of hell, or those who are afraid of God. The cowardly. Why? Because even though you come to church and even though you pray to God, you are afraid. You have a fear. You have a doubt about your salvation. So, 1 John chapter 4 verse 18 says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. What does that mean? If you have received God's love, if you truly understand the perfect love of God, you have no fear. If you are truly born again, if you are truly saved, you have no fear about hell or rapture. I told you yesterday, right? Some Christians, they say, oh, I'm not so sure whether I will be raptured when Jesus comes again. They have a doubt, they have a fear, then you are not born again. Because there's no fear in love. What is salvation? It's understanding God's love and understanding what Jesus has done for you. If you are truly born again, you have no fear at all. You have a hope. You will see God in heaven. So, if you have any fear or any doubt, then you are not born again. For those who are fearing, those who have a fear, your conscience tells you you are not truly saved, and that's why you have a fear. Okay? And then the next one, the unbelieving. If you do not believe, unbelieving is a sin. Let me tell you, we respect our father and mother because they gave birth to me, and then they raised me, they supported me, they helped me, right? So when, because of the sacrifice of father and mother, we honor them, we respect them. But who is God? God is the one who created you. God is the one who gave you your father and mother or so. So, if you do not believe God and if you do not recognize God, it's a terrible sin. Unbelieving people, unbelieving, they go to hell. And abominable means those who committed serious sins, those who are in the prison, they are going to hell, of course. Murderers go to hell, but you learn that Jesus said, if you hate your brother, you are a murderer. Sexually immoral goes to hell, but if you look at a woman or look at man with lustful heart, you go to hell, Jesus said. And sorcerers, idolaters, worshipping idols, not believing God, of course they are going to hell. And the last one is important. Who is going to hell? All liars shall have their part in the lake. Have you lied once? Then you are a liar. And all liars shall have their part in the lake. Do you know, you might say, how can God send a sinner to hell with one lie? It goes like this. If you have a high position, people expect higher morality. For example, for President of Korea, if he lies, it's a big problem, right? And we cannot say to the president, you are a liar, without the proof, because it's a really serious matter. President should not lie. And God never lies, by the way, right? God is much higher than president. And any liar cannot be with God. All liars go to hell. So this is the list of the people who go to hell, which is, you know, this is the picture of the sun. The air, air in the sun is very hot, 1 or 2 million degrees. 1 or 2 million degrees. So you have to know that God can even create such a hot, you know, that place. And among all kinds of pain, the pain from the burn, the fire burn is the, you know, most painful, excruciating. So please remember what kind of place hell is. Let me show you one video clip about this white throne judgment. Originally it's Chinese but Korean dubbed. So let me just show you.
죽음 후에는 모든 사람이 하나님의 보좌 앞과 전사 앞에서 심판을 받으리라. 내가 살았노니 모든 무릎이 내게 꿇을 것이요 모든 혀가 하나님께 자백하리라.
因此你不能用钱财赎回你自己至于那些胆小
두려워하는 자들과 믿지 않는 자들과 흉악한 자들과 살인 자들과 음란한 자들과 귀신 우상 숭배 자들과 모든 거짓말하는 자들은 불과 유황으로 타는 못에 던지우니 이것은 둘째 사망 곧 불못이라. 누구든지 생명책에 기록되지 못하는 자들은 불못에 던지우리라. 두 몸과 영혼이 밤낮 힘을 얻지 못하고 거기서 슬피 울며 이를 갈고 영원히 고통 가운데 있으리라.
咬着他们的蛀虫永远不死焚烧他们的火焰永远不熄.
So this is the warning. Okay, this is what will happen to sinners, and everything is written very clearly in the Bible so that we cannot be mistaken. No. God made it clear what will happen to the sinners, how He will judge people, and we know we are all sinners. So whatever we learned today, let me show you one more video clip which is summarizing the law and, you know, the sin of ours. So the title is, Are You a Good Person? So this is kind of the summary of what we learned this session. Let me show you.
Meet Mr. Nice Guy. You think you're nice? This guy is really nice.
Well, I try to do what's right.
He's so nice that if good people get to heaven, he'll be the first in line.
Ah, shucks.
So, Mr. Nice Guy, have you kept the Ten Commandments?
Pretty much.
Do you mind if we take a look at them and maybe see how nice you really are?
Okay.
Great. Here's one. You shall not lie. Mr. Nice Guy, have you ever told a lie?
Well, yeah. Who hasn't?
What do you call somebody who tells lies?
A liar.
All right. How about another commandment? You shall not steal. Have you ever stolen anything, even once?
Nope.
But you just told me you're a liar.
Well, I did steal some candy once when I was a kid.
And what do you call someone who steals?
A thief.
All right, let's try another one. You shall not commit adultery.
Oh, that's easy. I'd never cheat on my wife.
Hi, handsome.
Oh, baby!
Jesus said, if you even look at a woman with lust, you've already committed adultery with her in your heart.
Oh, right.
One more. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Have you ever used God's name to curse?
Oh my!
That, Mr. Nice Guy, is called blasphemy. God gave you life and breath and everything you have, and you've dragged His name through the dirt. So, by your own admission, you're a liar, a thief, a blasphemer, and an adulterer at heart. And that's just four of the Ten Commandments.
Okay, so I'm not perfect.
Well, actually, it's worse than that. Suppose we could put a chip in your brain that would record all your private thoughts for an entire week and then play those thoughts on a giant movie screen for all your friends and family to see.
That would be embarrassing.
Yeah, I know. The Bible says God knows everything, even the secret thoughts of your heart.
Well, compared to some people, I'm a saint.
Yeah, that's true. But the standard is God's law, not other people. Besides, even if you sin just 5 times a day, in 1 year, that's 1,825 sins. And if you live to be 70 years old, you'll have broken God's law over 127,000 times. You'll have to answer for every sin on Judgment Day, when the Bible says each of us will give an account of himself to God.
But God will forgive me, right?
Well, let's try that in court.
Hey, look, I know I keep breaking the law, but hey, catch up, well, you know, just let it slide.
Only a corrupt judge would buy that. A good judge would say,
justice demands that you pay for your crimes.
God's not a corrupt judge. He's a holy, righteous judge. He hates sin. Jesus warned that on Judgment Day, everyone who had sinned against God would justly end up in a terrible place called hell.
Right? So, he thinks he's a nice guy, but he broke many laws, Ten Commandments, in action or in his heart, and he will end up in hell because of all his sins. The part, if you commit sin 5 times a day, right? Actually, we are committing sin more than 5 times a day because in our thought or in our mind, we commit more sins than that. But if you commit 5 sins a day, if you live 70 years, how many sins are there? 127,000 sins, right? So many, and then for each of them, you'll be accountable for each of the sins, and then that means the sinner will go to hell. So this is the fact. We are all sinners. We are born as a sinner. We committed so many sins, and the hell is the place for sin after the judgment. And that's why we need to be saved. We need salvation. So let me show you just 2 more verses and we'll finish. You might say, okay, Pastor, I admit that I'm a sinner. I committed so many sins and I'm on the way to hell. Because I told you, sinner means the people who are going to hell. That's the same. Sinners, people go to hell. People who are going to hell. That's the same. So if you admit you're a sinner, you're wondering what I can do. What should I do? I know I will go, I'm going to this eternal lake of fire. Pastor, what can I do? This is the answer. Psalm number 34, verse 18. Let's read it together. The Lord is near to those who have a broken heart and saves such as have a contrite spirit. God wants from you the broken heart. What is broken heart? You have to admit, you have to confess. God, I'm a sinner. Please help me. That is broken heart. Contrite heart means repentant heart. God, I repent whatever I have done. Please help me. That is broken heart and contrite heart. Also, Psalm number 51, verse 17. Let's read it together. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. Yes. Broken and contrite heart. That's what God expects from sinners. If you have a broken heart, you have a hope. You have a hope for your salvation. Because God loves you. Okay? God loves you. But only sinners can receive salvation. If you think you are righteous or you are good enough, like this nice guy, you have no chance. Because you will never think that you need salvation. Okay, so in the next session after lunch, I will talk about how sinners can be saved and how sinners can go to heaven. And next session is the last session and the most important session. Okay, so please come again and then
with a broken heart and a contrite heart. Maybe you can pray alone after lunch. You can pray to God, God, please help me. I heard that I'm sinner, and for sinner, this terrible lake of fire and judgment and punishment is waiting for me. Please, God, please save me. So if you pray like that, God will answer your prayer, and you know, you'll find out what Jesus has done for you to save you in the next session. Okay, let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we heard this bad news today that because of the Adam's sin, we have become sinners, and we are born as sinners with a sinful nature, and with a sinful nature, we committed so many sins so far. So Lord, we have no hope whatsoever. Even our good work, our own righteousness is like a filthy rag, so we cannot cover ourselves with our good work, Lord. So Lord, we have no hope, and only the eternal hell is waiting for us. So Lord, please help us, and please save us from this eternal destruction, and please give us chance for our salvation. So Lord, please help us to come again for the last session when we can listen to the gospel message so that we can understand God's love and we can find out why Jesus came and what he has done and why he died on the cross. So Lord, please help us. Thank you so much for this time. And in Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.